Oi, Gilmores! Olha eu aqui outra vez para mais uma entrevista exclusiva com alguém do elenco de Gilmore Girls. Eu conversei com o queridíssimo George Bell, que era querido de todo mundo do elenco. Na série ele interpretou o Professor Bell lá em Yale quando a Rory estava na faculdade. E, além disso, ele era o treinador de diálogos de Gilmore Girls. Se vocês conseguem ver todo mundo falando rápido, é graças a ele, porque era ele quem conduzia tudo isso. E a gente bateu um papo muito legal. O George Bell é assim um anjo de pessoa, ele foi muito amável comigo desde o começo, desde quando a gente teve os primeiros contatos por e-mail. Não esquece de se inscrever no canal, de deixar o seu like aqui embaixo e de ativar as notificações para receber todas as novidades que a gente está fazendo aqui nesse mês de outubro e novembro em comemoração aos 20 anos de Gilmore Girls. A gente volta semana que vem com mais uma entrevista aqui no YouTube. E fiquem ligados também para todos os vídeos que vão sair durante toda a semana aqui. Fiquem agora com a entrevista exclusiva com o George Anthony Bell, o Professor Bell de Gilmore Girls.
He's been in the business for so long, probably many of you weren't even born. He acted in so many TV shows like Ally McBeal, ER, even Stevens, movies like Lady Killers with Tom Hanks, and of course, Gilmore Girls, where he got the chance to play Professor Bell in the original series and Stanley in the revival. But what many of you don't know is that he had an important part on the show. Fast-paced dialogues are a quintessential part of Gilmore Girls, and George is the reason why we can enjoy them. He worked on the show's dialogue coach, and Scott Patterson said recently on Twitter, George Bell was our Gilmore Girls secret weapon. Without George, there was stress. With George, there was joy and greatness. Gilmore Girls Hall of Fame first Bell inductee. I'm honored to introduce you to Mr. George Anthony Bell, aka George Bell, Gilmore Girls dialogue coach. Since he's the person who was present in every single moment on the show, I think he has a lot of stories to share with us, and we are going to do this right now. Hey, George, how are you?
Hola! I'm good. I'm great. Good. I'm so happy to be here.
I'm so happy to have you here, too. I want to thank you for saying yes to this interview. I'm ready for the questions, so I'm really glad to have you here with us in Gilmore Girls Brazil. We love your incredible work.
Thank you.
How did your artistic career begin, and how did you end up in Gilmore Girls?
I started in college. I wasn't a theater major at first. I switched several times. I was political science, then music, but then I did some shows on campus for extra credit, and the department chairman of theater came up to me and said, why aren't you a theater major? I thought you were a theater major. And I said, no, I'm not. He said, no, you need to be a theater major. So I eventually switched over to theater as my major. And then right out of college, I got my first professional show in theater. And for many, many years, I did theater. I did a couple of Broadway shows. I was in Cats. I was the show called Timbuktu, which was the all-black version of Kismet, and it starred Eartha Kitt, who was a big legend in her time, and The Wiz, which was the all-black version of The Wizard of Oz, and so I did a lot of theater. So Ain't Misbehaving, so I did a lot of shows.
You did Guys and Dolls too, right?
I did Guys and Dolls. I was Nicely, and so yes, so I did all of that. And then I eventually wanted to segue into doing television and film.
I'd like you to welcome our new principal and our old principal, Mr. Wexler.
I'm back.
As most actors do, pretty much you want to try and get into all aspects of acting if you're lucky enough. And I was lucky enough to be able to make the transition into doing film and television. And how I came to Gilmore Girls, one of my dearest, dearest friends, Carla McCloskey, who was the first AD on the show, and she also was a UPM. She's done a lot of stuff. Well, anyway, Carla married one of my best friends, and I sang in their wedding, and we're old friends. So Carla has done, I think that's how I got on Ally McBeal too. Carla has done some of the biggest movies in the business. And apparently on Gilmore Girls, they were starting the third season and they had never had a dialogue coach before. And Amy decided that she really, really wanted the actors to focus in on saying the lines word perfect, no different changes. That had to be exactly as she had written it because she heard it in a certain way and she wanted it to be delivered in a certain way. So she said, let's bring in a dialogue coach so to help the actors out so that they can do what I want them to do. So it would only help them. But we need to find someone who, you know, who the actors will be okay with, because, you know, when you're into the third season, you're kind of already into your groove and you kind of know. And so someone new coming in and going to basically give them corrections, it's not the easiest thing to do. So they needed to have someone to have the right personality and also the expertise to do it. And my good friend Carla said, I know who.
And you had so, that right.
Right. And so I was brought in, but I had to interview. I interviewed first with Amy and another producer. Mm-hmm. And then I think they got it down to four of us. And then the four of us interviewed with Lauren. And so Lauren interviewed each of us individually. And she selected me. And so, and that's how I came on the show as their dialogue coach.
And thank God you made it, right?
Yes, yeah. It was, who knew, you know? When I first started out, trust me, I was like, what the hell did I get myself into? This is hard. but it ended up being great. And the cast was just really wonderful. And we're still very close to this day, you know. I mean, if I were to run into them, there would be big hugs and kisses. Well, we can't hug and kiss anymore right now, but yeah. Well, we used to be able to do that.
What's the most memorable moment that you never forget about the show, about the people you met, about everything?
Oh my God, that's hard. I think it's just, you know, because the show was difficult, but the actors were so good, they made it look easy, but it really was difficult. So you really come together as a unit, as a family. I don't know, it's just the camaraderie. But one of the nicest things that happened to me is that Lauren and Alexis, every year for Christmas, because we would get like 3 weeks off of Christmas hiatus, every Christmas they would do coffee mugs with some kind of Gilmore Girls theme. And so this one particular year, they decided to do a coffee mug, which I have right here.
Oh,
I don't
nice.
Know if you can see it.
I totally see it.
And it says all over it, it says George. And it's Gilmore Girls 2005. So that was the theme. And everyone in the cast and the crew got this coffee mug. The reason why it says George is that whenever we would do a scene and we would do a take, each time you did it, it was a take. Sometimes you did 25 takes, 20 takes, 15 takes before we could move on. Many times when the director says, okay, cut, then if I'm on book, if I saw there were some mistakes, I would say, wait, you know, just a minute. And then the crew, the whole crew, they would start chanting my name, George, because they were wanting the overtime. So because if we had to do it again, because we worked really long hours, so they were like, oh, their paychecks are going to be bigger. So they were loving it that they were having to do it again. So they would go, George. So that became the mantra. So that's how that happened. So it was really a sweet tribute that both Lauren and Alexis did for me that year. So it's a keepsake that I will always cherish.
That's so nice to know about that. What does exactly a dialogue coach do? Explain to our audience, because many of people doesn't have no idea about that.
A dialogue coach, and most people make the mistake, they think dialogue coach is a dialect coach. Totally different. Dialect is like if you're going to talk with a British accent or Brazilian accent or Irish, or that's dialect. Dialogue, I am like the word police. So I am there on script and with my headphones on and everything, and I'm looking as they're saying their lines. I'm going, looking, and I have my own little kind of shorthand symbols that I would, if they missed a word or they mispronounced a word or a word wasn't clearly, I didn't understand it, where they kind of got tongue-tied or something. So I made corrections. Also, because I'm an actor, I know what they're going through. So quite often when you're an actor, you think you're saying the line correctly, but quite often you're not. So when I would go up to give an actor a correction, what did I say? And so I had to try and write down what they said incorrectly so that when they said, what did I say? Oh, you said such and such, such and such. And they go, oh yeah, right, okay. They would make the adjustment and they could do it. So I basically I'm the word police. Now, certain actors didn't want me to give them, they didn't want to know what they said incorrectly because it would only confuse them more. Like one of the sweethearts, Liz Torres, Miss Patty. She don't tell me what I said wrong. just tell me what the line is. So I knew how each actor worked. So I knew how, okay, with this person, I could do this. This person didn't do this. This person, I don't tell them what they said wrong. I just give them the correction and they would do it. And those three ladies on the screen behind me, they were phenomenal because the amount of dialogue that they had to learn on a daily basis, I couldn't do it. I don't know how they did it, but they did do it. Lauren is really smart. She's really, really smart and quick. Kelly comes from theater. We're both musical theater buffs. So, you know, she was in the original cast of A Chorus Line, and she won the Tony Award. And we were both doing theater at the same time. So we bonded. So Kelly's my girl. Whenever she come on the set, we sit together and we just kind of gossip all the time. Alexis was just such a sweet, sweet little, just a really sweet, sweet girl. And not to see that she's a mom now, and it's just amazing. So I had a wonderful rapport with all of them, you know, just loved them all very dearly.
You answered two questions that I was going to ask you in this answer. I was going to ask you about what's the actor that memorized the lines quickly and which one was the most difficulty to teach the lines?
Okay. Well, these three ladies were some of the best. Also, who was really very good, Liza, who played Paris.
Love her.
Kirk, Sean Gunn, he was very good.
Keiko also, right?
Keiko was
good.
I saw
on the season 7 extras, there are video, and you are teaching her how to memorize the lines, and she gets really, really fast.
It's my last night with my best friend. It's the last night or it's my last
it's
night?
It's my last night.
It's my last night with my best friend. How's that? That's pretty good. Yeah. That's actually pretty good. If we got it that close, cha-ching.
You learn all kind of tricks, you know. Sometimes it's just doing it with a rhythm and they hear the rhythm. Because Todd, I remember I did that with Todd. Todd got all excited. Yeah, that worked, you know. Or even like a little, almost like a song thing. I remember one time, Carol, she was having difficulty with this particular line. And so Carol King, George. And so when I went up to her, I said, Carol, think of it as a little song, like a little rhythm. And I kind of sang it with a little rhythm. And she went, and I'm like, I'm singing a line to Carol King? Whoa.
The legend.
but you just learn little tricks of the trade to help. The person who had the most difficulty with the lines, it doesn't mean they're not a good actor. You can be a good actor and just be slow with picking up lines. I think one of the most challenging for me, and he was a great guy, and he even directed, I think, a couple of episodes, was Jackson. He was, I think maybe because that wasn't really his forte, so having to do the lines, because I know many a guest actor, we had a couple of people almost had a nervous breakdown on the set because they couldn't, not only did they have to know the lines, but then I would have to say, now Gilmorize it, which meant speed it up. This one lady, she was so sweet and so nice, but she couldn't take the pressure. And at one point, she just, we were running lines and I was just, you know, and she wasn't quite, it wasn't sticking. And I'm, you know, I'm trying to, I try to be like a safety net for everybody. I try to be very nurturing and, you know, I don't, you know, you don't want to become, come off judgmental or like, you have to really just kind of, and be supportive because, you know, you're feeling vulnerable and you, and insecure anyway. So, but this one lady, she just was having such a hard time that she paused and she just looked at me and said, I want to go home.
I read about that on the Gilmore Girls companion book.
Right. Yeah. I want to go home. I said, no, you can't go home. We'll get through this. We ended up having to write the lines on big boards in the back of the classroom off camera so she could look at the lines that way and get through it. So when they decided to make me Professor Bell, I had found out the night before that I shot the scene.
Had a great difficulty about your lines, right? About your monologue. I read about that too.
It was the most horrifying experience I'd ever had because the day before, when you do the last episode, the last day on an episode, it takes 8 days to do an episode of Gilmore Girls. So sometimes during the week, scenes get postponed, you get delayed, you don't get to everything, and you push it. So on that last day, you got to get everything. So that last day can be a really long day because you want to get everything done. So we were like, I don't know, 12 hours into the day. And you know, then traditionally they'll give you the scripts for the next episode, you know, they pass them out to everyone. So I'm there, I'm still working. And it comes, oh, George, you're going to be a professor in the next episode. One of the reasons why I became the Professor Bell on the show is they had problems with a lot of the people who play teachers or professors. And they would choke. And I went, that's nice of Amy and Dan, because they know I'm an actor and everything. I said, that's really nice. So I'm thinking they're going to just give me a couple of lines, you know, one or two lines, you know, I'm just, you know. And so then they gave me the script and it was originally a page and a half monologue.
Oh my God.
And I'm like,
are you serious?
And that's what I said. I said, are you serious? And then on top of that, they tell me, and by the way, because of the scheduling, your scene is the first scene up tomorrow. First scene up. So, well, when am I going to have time to learn the lines? Because I'm still working on this episode. We still got several more hours. And I got to try and memorize this. I'm already half brain dead. So between when they're setting up the shot for the next scene, I'm trying because you're tired and you just, nothing is sticking. And I was just like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And then you have the added pressures that I'm the dialogue coach. So now I'm the actor. And so now it's on me. And so all the other actors are there. Mm-hmm. Now let's see what you're going to do. Okay. Now it's your turn. You know, so I'm having that kind of pressure. Like I got to be perfect. I got to do this. And so finally, when I get home, I'm still trying to learn the lines. And I must have been like at 2 o'clock in the morning. My doorbell rings. Script changes. So suddenly, what I had learned was that was out, and I had to learn. And I'm like, and so I didn't sleep that night. And so that next day, I was like a walking zombie.
I can imagine.
And somehow I got through it. And the thing that I'm most amazed at, I said, Dory, you must be a pretty good actor because I look so calm in the scene. And believe me, on the inside, I was dying. I was like, oh, but I did it. And I guess I must have done a good enough job because they let me do it more times. So as the professor, so it was great. Yeah.
While I was reading about that in the book, I thought he must be a very good actor to do that. And you are.
Well, that took a hold. That was probably the hardest thing I have ever had to do as an actor. Just sleep deprived, not feeling really prepared, and just the added pressure that I put on myself. Because I have, you know, you have a certain level of where you think you should be. And I wasn't feeling that I was meeting that level. But when I saw the finished product, I was like, oh, okay, wasn't so bad.
It is almost always imposed with the explicit purpose of keeping power in the hands of the powerful. Something to think about until next week, when we will burst more of your illusions.
One of my favorite lines on the show is that on season 7, when Lorelai says, because my brain is a wild jungle full of scary gibberish, and then she starts saying about Bush, White House, Casablanca, and everything. That wasn't written by Amy Sherman Palladino, right? Which brings me to the question, what was it like working without her? Do you think it changed the rhythm of the show?
Amy and Dan, they're Gilmore Girls. Of course, the people that took over, they took it over with Amy and Dan's stamp of approval. And they did an admirable job. But the quality, it wasn't up to what Amy and Dan would have done with it, you know. And not taking anything away from them, they did a really a marvelous job. And I was really, you know, pleased with them. It was a lot easier because we didn't have the pressure of getting it right as much as we had to. But I'm just adding another picture for you.
Oh, nice.
And that's Amy and Dan.
Our parents. We call them our parents because they created.
But the actors didn't have as much pressure to get the lines as work. They were a little bit more loose. So it was, in certain ways, it was easier, but the quality of the writing, because, you know, they were, you know, we didn't know what Amy and Dan had in their brain as to what the show was going to be. Had they finished out, that's the season 7. So it's just a little. I mean, but the people who took over, lovely people, and it was a pleasant work environment, you know. Amy and Dan, they were missed.
I'm totally sure about that. We all suffered when the show got canceled, and when Amy and Dan left the show, it was a shock to all of us.
It was a shock to me, and when I found out, and in fact, Amy and Dan, they were so kind and so sweet to me. They came up to me and they said, look, we're not going to be coming back next season, but we've made it very clear that we want you to be coming back and that they are to bring you back and whatever it takes, because you are gonna keep the ship going. So they made sure that I was well taken care of. I got perks on the show that I wouldn't have gotten on other shows because of Amy and Dan. And in fact, I told them, I said, look, I said, I'm kind of semi-retired from the dialogue coaching, but I said, I'll make an exception. If you guys ever call me and want me to come, if I can do it, I'll do it, you know, for them. You know, so because I love them so much. They're just great people.
Did you imagine that Gilmore Girls would come back for a revival 9 years after its ending and that you would be able to work with them once again? I mean, it was a blessing to all the fans.
The first couple of years, you kind of hope. Then you just kind of put it out of your mind and thought, okay, you know. And then, of course, when the rumors started coming back again that it might be happening, I said, really? 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 Oh, okay. And then you kind of go, well, you know, if it comes back, you know, there's no guarantee who's going to, you know, if they're going to bring you back. But to my delight and surprise, Amy told me that they're getting things together because they had to first talk to, you know, Lauren, Alexis, and Kelly. Because if you don't have them, you don't have a show. And so when they were all on board, one of the first things Lauren said, and you're going to get George, aren't you? You're going to get George. And they said, of course we're going to get George. So it was really sweet that they wanted me to be there. So I was one of the few people that actually came back who did the original. The crew. And I think Brenda, who did the wardrobe, She came back, and a couple of the dressers. So there were only a couple of us that came back that had worked on the show previously.
You're an important part of the puzzle.
Well, I guess so. And it's nice to be needed and loved.
Yeah. As a dialogue coach, you must receive the script in advance and study its pitch right. How does it feel to carry such a responsibility in your hands?
Actually, you don't get the script that much in it. You get it pretty much the same time as the actors do.
Really?
So there's really no time to study it. I found for me, you just have to be in the moment. So, you know, traditionally, when you report to set that day, they have something that's called sides. Sides are the scenes that you're going to do that day. It may be 8 to 15 pages of dialogue. So what I'll do is just, I'll just concentrate. I'll go through all of that, you know, and mm-hmm. just to look to see if there are any words that, because Amy and Dan, they have all these great references of things. And so so just to make sure that I understand the dialogue, that if there's a word that I'm not sure about the pronunciation, I have my little trusty electronic dictionary that I would, you know, refer to if I needed to. Yannick, is French Canadian, so French is his first language. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, you know, he would ask me about certain references of things so that he could understand what it actually was and the pronunciation of things. You know, you do your homework like everyone else. I was just amazed at how when the girls would get the script, sometimes they would just get the pages right there just before we were going to shoot the scene. Oh, and they had God, to really? Learn the lines. Oh yeah, that happened a couple of times. And I'm like, and they would sit there, and it wasn't the most ideal circumstances. And certainly it was very stressful. But one of the tricks I learned from both Lauren and Alexis is that on the back of their sides, you know, they're about 5x7 page, you know, they would write the lines out, I'd ask them, I said, why do you write the lines out? They said, because writing it out somehow helps lock it into the brain to help them with the memorization. And I went, oh, and I use that now whenever I go, if I'm going on something as an actor, I'd write down the lines, and believe it or not, it does help you. It's a lot of work, and it's really, really difficult to try and, learn everything. And believe me, the older you get, it gets to be a little bit more difficult, you know, so.
Alexis, she's so pretty.
Yeah. I remember when the two of them were first a couple, an item, you know, and they were trying to keep it on the down low. They didn't want people to know, but it was really sweet. This was when Melissa worked on the last, I think it was the last, we were working, it was maybe the last day.
It was the last day. She came to do her scene in the last day.
Right. So Melissa was there. This guy is Sean. He was the other first AD. He wasn't working on the show, but he came to visit that day. And of course, there's Yannick. But that was a fun day, having Melissa there.
I remember we all freaked out when we saw Melissa and Yannick together.
Yeah, it was just a lot of fun. Here's another one. Matt was sick as a dog. That was his first day working, and he was coming down with a cold, bless his heart. This was an all night shoot.
I remember when all the photos were being leaked and we all freaked out about it. Your Instagram was a huge source of photos. We all freaked out when you post photos.
Oh, cool. Because I was just going to tell you to tell your friends, fans, to go to my Instagram if they want to, because that's where all these pictures are.
Yeah, we all, in our website, there's a lot of photos from your Instagram.
Oh, good. I'm glad.
Since we are talking about the revival, I want to ask you something about it. Did you know the last 4 words before everyone, or just when the show, the episodes were aired on Netflix?
How I found out, of course, we knew they were going to be the last 4 words. It was very hush-hush. I didn't even know. And in fact, how I found out of what the last four words were. We had shot a scene on the gazebo prior to the last four words. And so we were shooting, so we shot the scene, you know, and I got my headphones on, and so the only people that had the headphones on would be me, of course, the director, and the sound people, you know, with the boom, you know, and that's about it. Nobody else can hear what's being said. And so, so then I thought we had finished the scene, but then I saw them still sitting there. And then they were getting ready to roll again. And I thought, oh, I guess they're doing another take. So I'm, and then I'm, then I hear, Mom, yeah, I'm pregnant. And I'm like, four words. And I went, oh, that's how I found out. And I said, I know the last four. I didn't say anything to anyone. But that's how it was very, you wouldn't have known because most of all the other people, they didn't know what was going on. So it was just done very, very cleverly. And yeah, it was fun. They were very sneaky about it, which I enjoyed. It was nice to kind of know that I was in on it, you know, so.
Yeah. And what did you think about the last four words? Did you think that in the folk circle that Amy always thought about it?
I never know where Amy's going to take you or what's going to happen. So you just kind of go with the flow. And of course, like everybody else, I want to know who the daddy is.
Oh, is too.
It? You know, and so of course, all it's done is fed the rumor mill about, are we going to come back again? Are they going to come back again to reveal who the daddy is?
Do you think there's going to be more Gilmore Girls in the future?
I don't know. What I do know is one time I remember Lauren saying that she could see maybe doing like a Gilmore Girls Thanksgiving, like a 2-hour special, or a Gilmore Girls Christmas, something like that, that would maybe they could come back for 2 hours and maybe wrap things up. I don't know. I mean, with each passing year, it gets more difficult because, you know, Milo has his show.
Yeah, everyone is involved in different projects.
Yeah, yeah.
You have no idea how many messages I get every day asking about a new season, and I always have to say the same thing. I don't know. They don't know. Yeah. Nobody knows.
Only Amy and Dan know, and I imagine if it's going to happen, it's going to be, they got to talk to the big three, and to Scott. And if they have them on board, you know, I can imagine then they can pretty much do whatever they want to do. And they have to, and I think also the script has got to make sense. You know, it's got to be something that's going to make sense for Alexis and for Lauren and for Kelly to want to do it.
Just like it did on the revival.
Right. So I never say never. So it's possible that they could do it, but you know, I don't have an inkling to if they will or not.
I know everyone loves you and you are a great friend, listener, and sometimes a shrink to all of them. Which cast member did you stay close with after the show ended?
Patty. Of course, Patty Malcolm, who, because Patty and I started around about the same time on the show. You know, it's kind of weird as an actor, you know, you work with people and you have this intense relationship the time you work with them. And then you may not see each other for years. But then if you do run into each other somewhere, it's like no time has elapsed. It's just that connection will always remain. So with all of them, you know, I would give them a big hug and, you know, and I don't see any of them, except because of the Gilmore Girl Fan Fest that they have every year. I see those actors at least once a year and it's great. We keep coming back and it's fun just to be able to visit. And of course we're doing the, Are you going to do the virtual fan fest? You're going to tune in for that on October 17th. So it's nice to see everyone that that way. I hadn't seen Scott in a long time until this fan fest last year. And so it was great because I did a couple of things with him when he had some projects. I came and I read lines and, you know, coached him. And Yannick, I coached a few times. And you get messages exchanged, like you run into someone and say, oh, so-and-so says hello to you. And I said, oh, give him my love. And so you kind of communicate that way.
Tell us a fun fact that you never told anyone about your experience working in Gilmore Girls. Something that happened on behind the scenes that you always wanted to tell anyone and you never told.
I'll tell you, one time they played a gag on me that was real funny, and in fact it related to that time, the first time I did the professor. And everyone, and that was the crew was so, they were so great because they all knew the pressure that I was under for that I didn't have any time to learn the lines. And they were all like, they were pulling for me because they knew that I was like, you know. I think it was the Yell episode when I was Professor Bell, where they have the fight in the classroom. Logan and Colin, they fight over Rory. That particular scene, I had the time, they gave me the lines and everything, and I had a couple of days, so I was totally comfortable and ready. And so, and on those days that I do the dialogue coaching, with the exception of the reboot, whenever I acted, I didn't do dialogue coaching. So I had a sub that would come in and sub for me. So the crew decided to do a trick on me to try and make me crazy again. So whenever you, when you get your pages, they're a certain color. So usually the first pages, they're white. Okay. If there are any changes made to the dialogue or stuff, then they're like maybe blue. Then if they make changes again, then they might be green. Then if they change again, they might be gold, you know, which rarely ever happens. You know, it's like, what the hell, you know? So they were making all these changes, pretend changes for me to try and get me all worked up. So they kept knocking on my door, and then they came and said, changes to your scene. I'm like, changes in my scene? You know, I'm like, but I already know. Okay. So I'm like, I'm trying to learn the lines. Like, okay, I can do that. Then about a half hour later, changes to the scene again. You know, so then it's time for me. I'm actually on the set getting ready. We're getting ready to set up to do the shot. And so I'm standing there. And then they come to me, changes to the scene. With the gold pages, I went, changes to the scene. Are we gonna? And I'm looking, and then I look out the corner of my eye, and I'm looking at the crew guys, and they're kind of.
They're all laughing.
And then I said, "You guys are with me," and everyone just fell out laughing, you know. So it was all a big joke that they were just that pulling my leg just to, because they knew how stressed I was the first time, so. But it, like I said, it was a camaraderie. We had fun.
So I want to ask you about if you have any TV or movie projects in the future.
Things have been really, really slow, but things are just starting to kind of start little by little. I mm-hmm. actually just did shoot a commercial for Xfinity, which is, I think an offshoot of Comcast, and it's for gigabytes or something. I don't know what the hell it is. But I play this person where this the guy who's the spokesperson, he's playing AT&T, but he's kind of obnoxious and just making himself at home in my home and just kind of so it's just me and him. I just shot that last month, and I think that's going to start airing. If it isn't airing now, it's going to air pretty pretty soon. So I'm going out. In fact, on Monday, I have an audition. Mainly it's been commercial auditions. I got an audition for something. I forgot what it is on Monday. So everything is now done like through virtually. So you audition and they look at you online, and then, which I think is going to be here to stay. And then if you get it, they take all the safety precautions, because as soon as I went on the set, went for my wardrobe fitting, I had to do the COVID test, and they had the little the thermometer to check you. And so, and they were really, really safety conscious about everything. I did an audition for a movie for Hulu, but I don't think I got that. I don't think I didn't hear anything back from that. So I guess I'm not up for that. But, you know, I'm auditioning. I mean, I'm not fully retired. Dialogue coaching, like I said, for Amy and Dan, I'm always available. I don't think they have a dialogue coach on The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, but that's shot in Brooklyn. So, you know, and I live in L.A. So it would be really hard for me to want to leave home to go back there. Although I heard a
rumor about Lauren that she's gonna be in Marvel or Mrs. Maisel. Do you know something about that?
I had heard that, and I heard that because Liza has done it.
Yeah.
So I it wouldn't surprise me. You know, I mean Lauren's a great actress. I mean, so
she's terrific.
And Kelly, I mean, I wouldn't be a bit surprised if she brought in a lot of people. I hope it'd be nice she brought me in. that I would love to do. I'd love to go there as an actor and do a little
bit. It would part be great to have you there.
Yeah, that would be fun. It'd be fun. So,
I love
and
that
just
show.
Good to see everybody.
So, George, I want to thank you for sharing that with us. Thank you so much for your kindness and being so friendly from the very first contact we had.
Hello, Brazil fans. We really, really appreciate having all of you as fans. Gilmore Girls was really a special time for all of us. It's, as I tell people, it's like comfort food. It's or an easy chair. It's just a really, just a wonderful show that I'm so proud to have been a part of, and that we really, really appreciate the fans all over the world. They're the best. They're always just so warm and welcoming, and it's just nice to be associated with the show, and I really appreciate being asked to to give some of my experiences with Gilmore Girls. And thank you for asking me.
Oh, I'm the one who thanks you. So, bye-bye, George.
Bye-bye. Ciao, everybody. Thank you.